And I'm trying to figure out how to do this passage. The whole thing, verse 21 to 43, is one passage that has two different stories in it. But if we don't study the whole thing in one session, you don't get the emphasis and why the two stories are there. So what I'm going to do, I think, and I probably shouldn't tell you what I'm going to do and then not do it, but you need to get the flow of the thought so you can get it, and then there's a bunch of particulars that we need to go back and pick up. So I'm going to try tonight to go down through the flow of the thought so you can see why these two things are meshed together the way they are, and then next week we'll go back and get the particulars about the doctrines that are all involved in it, and you'll see what I'm talking about as we go down. So I'm going to try to do something which for me is almost impossible. I'm going to go from verse 21 to verse 43 in one session. And I'm telling you ahead of time, I ain't promising nothing, but that's my intention, okay? And I also don't intend to be here all night. That's good for you to know, right? Verse 21. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, and he's left the Gadarenes in the northern part where we were studying with the demoniac there, and he's come back to Galilee. Much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. So now he's come back to where he left when he went up into that area of darkness and delivered the guy up there, and he's come back. And behold, and when he gets back, there's all these people been waiting on him, and they've been anxious, where is he? And behold, there came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him, and thronged him. So you get the picture. Here's a ruler of the synagogue, Jairus, who understands who Jesus is. He comes to him. He says, my little daughter. Now, his daughter turns out to be 12 years old. If you look down in verse 42, straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished. Now, you know, obviously, in the picture, if she's 12, what is 12 in the Bible? It's the number of the nation Israel. So the little girl is a picture of the nation Israel. She's sick, nigh unto death. And actually, in later on in the thing, she actually does die. And so she's a picture of the condition of the nation Israel. They're nigh unto death, they are dying, and ultimately are going to die. So the little girl, the ruler of the synagogue, What the vain religious system of Israel is doing is it's killing the nation. Now, Jesus is going to go to Jairus' house, and he's going to heal his daughter. So as they go, now obviously, he wants Jesus to get there in a hurry. You know, if you're sick, you need the little girl's sick, nigh unto death, let's go. Now, as he goes, verse 25, a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years. Now, this woman has been sick for 12 years. So for the 12 years the little girl was living, this woman has been suffering. Okay? To get that picture. And verse 26, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. Now, you know what that would be like, don't you? Come back with me, if you will, to Psalm 107. If you've been sick, and you've been sick for 12 years, and you've gone to every doctor you can find and done everything they said to do, and you're not any better, and you've spent all that you had, you're desperate. You're at your wit's end. That's the condition of this woman. Psalm 105, for example, verse number 27, talking about the condition that the nation Israel is going to be in one day. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man and are at their wit's end. That's really what you have to do to get saved. You have to come to the end of yourself, the end of your resources. Well, this woman has come to the end of her resources. She's bankrupt. And yet she's still sick. Now, she's got this issue of blood. Verse 26, go back to Mark. And had suffered many things of many physicians and spent all that she had and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. She's looked for all the physicians, all the help. Now, when you think about that, and she's got, that's the other crew going through. The other Wednesday night, somebody, we were moving all the chairs and stuff around, and all the kids came out and started helping, the teenagers came out and started helping, and somebody said, man, I didn't realize there were so many people in the building. This group of adults in here, you're not even half of who's in the building. That was another group of them that just marched through. Weren't they orderly? Usually they're screaming and hollering, but that was nice. Anyway, people watching on the internet don't know what I was waiting on. I was just watching them go through. I was waiting on them to throw something. They're kids, you know. Anyway, verse number 27. And when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. And she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Now this woman is going to be a picture of the believing remnant in Israel. If you go down to verse number 34, he said unto her, daughter. Notice she's not a woman anymore, she's a daughter. Now in Israel's program, many times the nation Israel is described as a woman. That symbolism is used. Mary is called, Jesus, when he addresses his mother, he always says woman, because she represents the seed of the woman, the seed of Abraham, and the bearer of the Messiah. And the nation Israel is identified that way. Jeremiah 6:2 is the great definitive verse on that. But here, this woman now is a woman of faith, and she's become the daughter. She's one of the daughters of Israel. She's a family member now. Verse 34, he said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. So she's going to be a picture of the believing remnant in Israel. Why that's important is here's the nation dying, and yet there's going to be a believing remnant in the nation. Now go back to verse 27. And when she had heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind and touched his garment. And she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. That's the dare of faith, because he says to her in verse 34, thy faith hath made thee whole. So she sees Jesus, she knows he's the Messiah, she knows he can heal her, and her faith reaches out and touches him. Now she touches his garment. Now that's important, because if you come over to Luke chapter 8, when you read about it in Luke chapter 8, verse 44, she came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood staunched. So she's got this issue of blood. She touches the hem of his garment, the border of his garment, and she's healed. Now, there's a lot of symbolism in that. Come back with me, if you will, to the book of Leviticus, chapter 15. Let's talk about this issue of blood just for a minute. Get Leviticus chapter 15 and Ezekiel chapter 36. Leviticus 15 and Ezekiel 36. She's got an issue of blood. She's passing blood. She can't get any help from it. Nobody can stop it. Nobody can help her. She's been doing this for 12 years. Leviticus chapter number 15, verse number 19. And if a woman have an issue, and her issue in her flesh be blood, she should be put apart 7 days, and whoso toucheth her shall be unclean until even. So here's a woman who has this condition. She's had it for 12 years. She's been unclean and separated for 12 years. She's been unable to go to the temple and worship. She's been set apart for all that time. Now, what that's a picture of, and you know the things in Israel, the sign, all these things in Israel back here, these statutes and so forth, were a picture of what God's doing with Israel. The ceremonial uncleanness and so forth was a picture of the doctrine that's being taught. And what's being taught there, if you come to Leviticus chapter 36, verse number 16. In this passage, Ezekiel is looking toward the restoration of the nation Israel into her kingdom. If you look down at verse 24, and I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean. By the way, if you go back to Leviticus 15 just for a second, the woman is to be separated. She is to be unclean. Now, when she can be, after the issue of blood is cleansed, Leviticus 15, verse 28, but if she be cleansed of her issue, then shall she number to herself 7 days, and after that she shall be clean. And on the 8th day, she's going to offer a sacrifice and so forth. And the first thing is she's separated, then she shall be cleansed, verse 28. Well, the way she's cleansed, go back to verse 13. But when he that hath an issue is cleansed of his issue, then he shall number to himself 7 days for his cleansing, and wash his clothes, and bathe his flesh in running water, and shall be clean. So the first step in cleansing is washing with water. Follow that? In Ezekiel chapter 36, the prescription for cleansing Israel starts in verse 25, with being sprinkled with clean water. And ye shall be clean. From all the filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. And a new heart will I give you. And a new spirit will I put within you. Regeneration. Verse 27, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you shall keep my judgments, and you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. He's going to restore them, give them the capacity to be his people, qualify them spiritually, so they can go into their kingdom. Now that's the issue in Ezekiel 36, is the restoration of Israel into her kingdom. Now go back to verse 16. He's explaining to them in this chapter why they're going to go off into captivity. Verse 16, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, when the house of Israel dwelt in their own land, they defiled it by their own way and by their doings. Their way was before me as the uncleanness of a removed woman. Now that's that lady back in Leviticus 15. Wherefore I poured my fury upon them for the blood that they shed upon the land, and for their idols wherewith they had polluted it. And for the shedding of that, see, there's an issue of blood here. There's a shedding of blood. And when the nation shed that blood, that idolatrous blood, on the land, it polluted the land, and he takes them out of the land, separates them out, dealing with them as that removed woman. She is moved out of the camp as unclean. So he took his nation out of the camp. So the issue of the removed woman, because of the issue of blood, here's a woman in Mark 5 that is a picture of all that. Now that's a picture of God. Why is Israel in captivity? Because of the shedding of the blood, the issue of blood. How do you get out of that? Well, there's a prescription for cleansing in Leviticus 26 and in Leviticus 15, applied in Leviticus 36. This woman comes as a picture of that. So she's going to be a picture of the remnant that God is going to redeem out of the nation Israel and take into the kingdom. So go back with me to verse Mark 5. She touches the hem of his garment. That isn't what the verse said. She touched his garment. I'm sorry. Luke says she touched the hymn writer said she touched the hem of his garment. See how easy it is to fall into, get your doctrine out of the hymns instead of your Bible? it's awful, isn't it? But it's habit. And boy, you got to be careful about that kind of habit. She touched the border of his garment, Luke 8 says. Now come back with me to Deuteronomy 22 and notice what that's talking about. Get Deuteronomy 22 in one hand and Numbers chapter 15. And, you know, if you don't study your Bible and you don't study all of the Bible, it's hard to understand the Bible, frankly. And when I say to you that when you read these passages, these incidents are there and there's details in them that mean something, it's because they match other things in the Bible. Deuteronomy 22. Verse number 12. He's talking about clothing. Verse 11. Thou shalt not wear a garment of divers sorts, as of woolen and linen together. You know, years ago, when the spectacle of preachers telling women what they could and couldn't wear, if there's ever been a dumber thing for a preacher to do, that's it. And the idea was women can't wear pants. The verse was verse 5. Women shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man. Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do are an abomination unto the Lord. Well, if you go to the book of Ruth or you go back over to Samuel, you'll see men wearing skirts. That's a problem. If a woman can't wear what pertains to a man, she can't wear a skirt. Well, you see, that's talking about cross-dressing is what that's talking about. And that's what's the abomination, not some lady wearing a pair of pants. But anyway, verse number 11. By the way, if you're going to use verse 5, you ought to use all the other verses in the chapter. Guys stand up and say, you women shouldn't wear pants. Verse 11, thou shalt not wear a garment of divers sorts. So if you got on a shirt with dacron and rayon in it, or cotton and mixed with two different materials, you can't wear that either. I never seen anybody wearing a suit that had a material, you know, unless you wore a wool suit. And that'd be, you know, if you wear any other kind of suit, it's got two or three different kind of fibers in it. But, you know, let's don't be technical. Let's just talk about what we won't talk about. That's not where I'm going. Verse 12. Thou shalt make the fringes upon the four corners of thy vesture, wherewith thou coverest thyself. Now, if you've got a fringe around what you're wearing, doesn't it sound like you're wearing a robe? be hard to put fringes around my pants, you know, around the four corners. Okay? So what's going on here is a Jew is told, when you put on your robe, you're to have a fringe around the bottom of it. Fringes around the four corners. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ, the reason she touched the border of his garment, she did, you know, why did she reach up and touch his shoulder? Why is she reaching down there to that border? Because the garment the Lord Jesus Christ was wearing demonstrated his obedience to the law. He was wearing exactly the garment that the Mosaic law said he was to wear. Now, for example, go back with me to Numbers chapter 15, verse 37. The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speaking of the children of Israel, and bid them that they make them fringes in the borders of their garments throughout their generations. So this is something that God required Israel to do. Have you ever seen an American flag with a fringe around it, with a little blue? You know what kind of flag that is? That's not the official American flag. That is, by statute, the military flag. That's not the constitutional flag. It's not the political flag. That border around the American flag identifies that flag specifically as a military flag. Well, the American flag is not a military flag. It's the nation's flag. But when you put that border around it, then you'd by, it's actually a federal statute that identifies it as that. Israel had a border around their garments that identified them as obedient to God's law. Verse 38, speaking of the children of Israel, and bid them that they make them fringes in the borders of their garments, throughout their garments, and that they put upon the fringes of the borders a ribbon of blue. And it should be unto you for a fringe, that you may look upon it and remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them. And that you seek not your own after your own heart or your own eyes, after which ye use to go a whoring, that ye may remember and do all my commandments, and be holy unto your God. I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God. And that fringe around the bottom of your garment, that blue, have you ever heard of blue laws? Most of you guys are so young, you can't even appreciate your own culture. When I was a kid, they had what was called blue laws. That is, a business couldn't open on Sunday unless it was a necessity. Sears had to be closed. Walgreens could be open. But Sunday blue meant you had to close, because they thought, erroneously, that Sunday was the Sabbath, and we're going to keep the law. That's actually where that title blue law came from, was that passage there. Now, that's got nothing to do with Mark 5, but come back to Mark 5. The reason she touches the border of his garment is because that border demonstrates that Jesus Christ is keeping the law. Now, that's important, because when you read the next verse, she said, if I touch but his clothes, I will be whole. So she's got this dare of faith to believe that here's the Messiah, here's the one who is keeping the righteousness of the law. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. So it worked. Now, Jesus immediately, knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him. I don't know about you, but I used to for years wonder, why does it say virtue went out of him? Because what went out was healing power. But virtue is not healing power. Virtue is righteousness. Then it dawned on me, oh, here is the one who has the righteousness of the law. He's got the righteousness she didn't have, but she needed to be healed. And his righteousness goes out and heals the woman. Not just physically, but spiritually. Jesus immediately knowing in himself that virtue, the righteousness of the law represented by that garment, had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched my clothes?" That's not a question of ignorance. That's like when Adam and Eve sinned and he said to Adam, "Where art thou?" He knew where he's hiding in the bushes. That's a question of accountability. Now, the disciples don't get it. His disciples said unto him, "Seest thou the multitude thronging thee? And thou sayest, who touched me?" I mean, are you nuts? Look at all the people. They're all touching you. And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing that what was done to her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. So she comes and confesses. But that's really why he asked the question. Because back in Psalm 50, he says, "I'll deliver you and then you'll glorify me." So when he delivered her, now she needed to glorify him. So she does. Verse 34. He said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." So there's this wonderful account of this woman who comes, sees the Messiah, contacts his righteousness, has that righteousness imputed to her, and cleanses her. Thy faith. He didn't say, "You're touching me, Major." He said, "Your faith that motivated the touch." The emphasis on her faith. She had a doctrinal understanding of what was going on. Faith comes by hearing by the Word of God. She didn't just say, "Maybe, hopefully it'll work." She said, "I know who he is. I know what that border symbolizes. And if I contact his righteousness, I'll get healing." Because that's where the healing for the nation is. And her faith made her whole. Now, that's a beautiful picture of the believing remnant trusting the Messiah and being restored. That woman, the removed woman, being restored, made ready for her kingdom. Now, the next verse is where the next verse tells you why all this is important. Verse 35, "While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further?" While he tarried and delayed going to the synagogue, to Jairus' house, in order to heal this woman, the little girl died. That's one of the great principles in your Bible and God's dealing with the nation Israel. He's on his way to heal her. He's going to do it. But he got delayed on the way to do a good thing. And while he delayed, she died. Do you remember in John 11 about Lazarus? He hears that Lazarus is sick. His sisters send for him. And he tarried 2 days and then went. And his sister says, "Lord, if you had been here, he wouldn't have died." You remember that? He delayed, and he said, "I delayed because I'm going to do something more spectacular, more marvelous than just healing him." In Israel's program, there is a principle of delay. Paul uses it in Romans 9. God says to Moses, "Go down and tell Pharaoh, let my people go." go down there and deliver my people. But then he says, but wait just a minute. Before you do, I'm going to show my power and I'm going to destroy Pharaoh. So he sent 10 plagues. Couldn't he have destroyed Pharaoh like that? Yeah. Why did he send 10 plagues? He sent 10 plagues, each one against 10 of the gods of Egypt. And he destroyed the gods of Egypt, the religion of Egypt, and demonstrated that he was God, big G, of all the little gods they had. Then he delivered Israel. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was an Israeli, I'd have said, hey, wait a minute, Mo. You didn't say God's going to come down here and do all this stuff. You said he's going. But what happened, he says, I'm going to deliver you. Be patient, but I got something else to do first. And then I'm going to do it. And in Israel's program, often God will say, I'm going to do this. Be patient, I'm going to do this first. And that's why he says, in your patience you shall possess your souls. Isaiah 28. Because here's the promise, but I got some other stuff to do first. Now he's going to go to Jairus' house and raise the girl from the dead. He's going to deliver the nation right out of the dry bones of death into their kingdom. But before he does it, he's got that little flock that he's going to redeem. So the delay principle here, and it's real important to follow that. The parables that Jesus taught were all about that delay principle. Verse number 36. As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. So he's only going to take that little group of people. Peter, James, and John are the little triumphant of the 12. They're the three people that he surnamed. You remember we talked about that back in chapter 3. Those three little leaders. So this, what's going to happen now is only for a remnant. He came to the house, verse 38, of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and they that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he said unto them, why makest thou this ado? Weep and weep and weep. The damsel is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed him to scorn. They looked and said, hey, she's dead. Look at her. Humanly speaking, she was dead. Jesus said, she's just asleep. Now, sleep is a metaphor for death in the Bible, but it's a metaphor for death because when you're asleep, eventually you do what? Wake up. Okay? That's why that word is used for physical death in the Bible, because there's a resurrection coming. When, humanly speaking, you look at death, it's over. You're just going to be a dirt bag. Carnival for the maggots. They were looking at it humanly. Christ says, no, she's just asleep. It's not permanent. And they laughed him to scorn. That's human viewpoint. But when he put them all out, notice, he gets rid of the unbelievers. He taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with them and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand. Only Mark, by the way, tells you that. That's one of the marks of the book of Mark. He's the servant. He takes her by the hand and said, Talitha cumni, which is being interpreted, and I'm glad he interpreted it for us. Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. He speaks the word of life. And straightway the damsel arose. Now, if you write down by that Ezekiel 37, the valley of dry bones, where he breathes life into them, the breath of his life, he speaks. the nation is resurrected from the graveyard of the nations. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with great astonishment. And he charged them straightway that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat. She gets up and she walks. And he says, feed her. All that's designed to demonstrate the complete, total resurrection and restoration. I had surgery. Many of you have had surgery. When I had the heart surgery, they didn't feed me for 3 days. Now they're pumping nutrition in your veins. This girl, she gets up, she walks, feed her. She's perfectly restored back to life. Complete restoration. That's what God's ultimately going to do to the nation. But first, before that kingdom comes, there's going to be a little flock that has to be formed. That little daughter of Israel that's prophesied. And he's going to do that, the little flock, before he brings the nation in at the kingdom, at his coming. You see how verse 30 it says, he cometh to the house. Here comes the Messiah to the house of Israel. And then he resurrects them. And again, if you go back to Ezekiel 37, you'll see the valley of dry bones where the Messiah comes, resurrects the nation out of the graveyard of the nations and puts them back into their kingdom. Does the things in Ezekiel 36 we read about a moment ago. Now, one other thing. Notice in verse 43, he charged them straightway that no man should know it. So who knows about what happened? Verse 37, Peter, James, and John, the little flock, mom and dad, Jairus' mom and dad, the daughters, Jairus and his wife, only the little flock, only the believers are privy to what's going on here. What were the parables? What did the parables do? They said, those without don't want it. The scoffers, she's dead, she's not asleep. You don't know what you're talking about. They don't get it. But the little flock does. You follow that? This whole passage is really a picture of what's going on in the life and the ministry of Christ. The point of it all, the underlying big thing in it, is that delay principle. Maybe I have gotten through enough of it to make it clear to you. He's going to resurrect the nation. But there's some things have to be done first. There's that issue of blood. There's that issue of that removed woman. There's that issue of the nation Israel, the reason they're in captivity having to be dealt with. So he's going to redeem them. Going to redeem that believing remnant. They're going to live to see the resurrection of the nation, and the rest are going to be turned away. So when you see the thing going on here, this is not just something for preachers to, some guy to come along have a sermon about. There's a picture laid out here for the nation Israel about what their future holds and how it's going to come about. Okay? All right. Hey, I can't believe in 40 minutes I went through that whole thing. That is not going to become a habit. But to me, that's an exciting thing to see that. And especially to me, that thing about the delay principle is the real kicker. Because Paul uses that in Romans 9 to explain, God says, I'm going to do this with Israel. I've got a prophetic purpose for Israel. But wait a minute, before I do that, I'm going to do something else. That is, form the body of Christ, the dispensation of grace. The body of Christ doesn't, the dispensation of grace doesn't negate, it doesn't abrogate, doesn't do away with the prophetic purpose. It just delays it. And that's important to understand. That principle works all through Israel's history. Three times in the life of the Lord Jesus, in his earthly ministry, he does this. And each time it's to demonstrate that because of the unbelief of the nation, he's delaying to form that little flock who are going to be the real righteous nation. And that issue about virtue going out, the righteousness of the law proceeding from the Messiah, making the nation righteous, healing them, and going in during the delay. Okay, praise the Lord.